Since 1988, when the Federated States of Micronesia was first recognized as an independent nation, thousands of its citizens have gone to the U.S. Nearly 40,000 Micronesians have moved to the United States. Not because they wanted to, but because they had to. Time for me to fly.
Most of my family relatives are in Hawaii,
Portland, Oregon,
Boston, Minnesota.
My three brothers live at Texas.
I'm in Park Falls, Wisconsin, but I work in Phillips, Wisconsin.
We're in Kansas City, Missouri.
Right outside of Junction City.
Topeka, Kansas.
We are in Iowa.
California.
One of my cousins is in Utah.
Everywhere you go, you can find Micronesian.
While it may not appear so at first, Micronesians leave their island home reluctantly, but for good reasons.
Some they went for school, and some they went for medication, some they went for work.
They're trying to make a living for themselves and their kids, and they know that here it will be very hard. Very few jobs, and especially the salary is very low.
In Goshai, you don't find many jobs here.
The app has very low salary.
Do they have work back home now?
Jobs in Palau, no, no good. In the States, yes.
I ain't got nothing to do back home now. No work.
The economy. It's kind of getting worse back home, so I'm kind of doing my best.
Rensley Segre, former governor of Kushrai, takes immigration personally.
When I was governor, every time I saw people leaving the place, I felt sad because, to me, that's failure on my part because I did not prepare the place well for them to continue wanting to stay here.
They rather live in a way that it's advanced, or I would say it's more modernized.
Jobs for Micronesians, once on the rise, are now disappearing.
In the 1970s to 1980s, the number of jobs was increasing something in the range of 40%. Since 1995, the government had to downsize due to the structure of the compact funding. But during that same time, our private sector has not been robust enough to absorb those people that have left the government. As a result, we see an increase in immigration, the number of people who are leaving the country in search of jobs during that same period has gone up and continues to go up.
The Compact of Free Association, an agreement between the U.S. and FSM that went into effect at the time of independence, provides islanders with free access to the U.S. and its territories. Micronesians have left in search of new opportunities abroad, at first to Guam, then to Hawaii, and later in ever greater numbers to the U.S. mainland. Many brought their families, or summoned them later, with the intention of staying in the U.S.
Immigrants have been going to the United States for many years. The first ones came from Europe. They started coming from countries in Asia as well. When Micronesians moved to the United States, they're doing the same thing that other immigrant populations have done for hundreds of years now. They are going there looking for new opportunities, fulfill their dreams. And that's not so different from most other immigrant groups that have come to the U.S. in the past. They can share their cultural traditions, but at the same time integrate into an American way of living.
So, how have they done?
Walk away if you want to.
I think people get the impression that when they come to America, they're gonna get rich, not realizing it's not that easy.
Well, you can run, but you can never hide.
It's different. I don't want to say it's better or worse, but it is different. And especially here in this country, different is usually looked down upon or just feared in general.
I guess when we first came, we were the first colored people that came to Park Falls.
They mistakenly like say amigo, or like they thought that we're Mexican.
This patient put a light on and I went in, asked her what she wanted. She looked at me and told me to go wash my face because she thought I was dirty.
We've had experiences with people calling us nigger. And our kids even in school had a hard time.
The first time was hard because I took it really seriously and personally, but the second time around, you know.
When I first came in, they were like, kind of hate me because I was brown and they're like black, white, yeah. But after a month, they found out that I'm a cool guy like that.
I think the biggest problem that we had was the drinking problem.
And I think it continues to be a problem for most of us that gets from the island there, you know, especially for men.
Out here, when you drink and drive and they catch you, they will put you in jail. No such thing as we'll give you a ticket or what, they'll take you right away.
And they also ended up paying a lot of monies if they do get DUIs and everything, and they get tougher to go to court, and they have to find their own attorney to defend themselves.
They're very strict with that. I mean, you might as well buy a ticket, fly all the way home, drink all you want, and come back.
My brother, he thinks that here in America, if he doesn't want to go to work, oh, he'll be fine. You know, he's got good jobs, but he just think that this is back home.
When I get off from work, Elsie go to work, and they make me stay late too many times. She went to work late every day. It don't really work out for us, so.
Time management, that is one of the poorest things that all the Micronesians are facing toward right now. They don't really know how to manage. They can't be on time at work.
Routine, schedule, you have to keep up with time. Everything goes by time.
We're so used to the Micronesian time.
Life here is, I would say it's hard because money is everything. If you don't work, you'll be on the streets. I mean, back home, if you don't work, you have your own land and you can plant your own food and go fishing whenever you want to.
They may be back there thinking that, you know, maybe they're just wasting their money here. But really, back there, you don't have to pay for rent. You don't have to pay for water.
It's very cold here. We run the heat, and my God, the heat costs like 1,000 or something like that. Very expensive with the car payments, electricity, water, phone, and stuff like that. I'm dying.
it's pretty hard to send, you know, when you have to pay bills here. It's more harder to live in the United States than in Micronesia.
You know, people back home don't understand. They think that we're having fun out there. We have money. No.
This is a very big place. It's a very loud place and very fast moving. It's really hard to hold, like, hold to the intentions or, like, you know, your original, like, goals.
If the person is really going to come here to help the family, then it's fine. But most people, when they come here, they're not used to seeing the kind of money that people make here. So when they get here and they make that amount of money, then they tend to forget their priorities.
Despite these setbacks, Micronesians are doing quite well. At first, Micronesians settled in a few metropolitan areas, Honolulu, Kansas City, Portland, Pasadena. Soon they spread out more widely to Central Florida and to South Carolina, to rural communities in Texas, and to southern Missouri and beyond. Today, Micronesians have moved outside their established enclaves to settle in smaller towns in even more remote areas. We traveled through four states in the Midwest to explore a few of the Micronesian communities that have sprung up in recent years. Park Falls, Wisconsin is a town of less than 3,000 people, about 60 of them Micronesian.
I came from California to Park Falls in 2003. We came up here to visit, and I kind of like it.
Many Micronesians now living in Park Falls were originally recruited to work in nursing homes.
My wife, she got how many cousins up here? Working at the place here, the nursing home right here.
As others came, they found work in town at this paper mill, or out of town at this plastics factory in Phillips, and at Buer's Sawmill in Prentice.
November, and I was excited because snow is falling. I always wanted to see it, feel it. Yeah, but then 4 years later, I'm like, no, I think I had enough snow.
I like the snow because I snowboard. That's the one thing I like.
people don't, you know, go around and make noises and troubles, you know. I like it here because it's more quiet and very peaceful.
Where are we today? Savage, in Minnesota. I came here and I like it, so I stay.
Most Micronesians in Savage, Minnesota were drawn by family already living here.
I have one auntie. She's been here for 25 years.
I have two sisters that they came here a long time ago. I moved here in 1999. And a year later, I went back and get my family.
Savage has a small but close Micronesian community.
I thought I was gonna die in Minnesota. It was too cold for me.
I was excited to see the snow.
First time I see it, I like it. Now, it's pretty much hard, but I'm used to it anyway, so. There's a few that work in the restaurant, which is my husband and the other guy. And mostly they do landscaping. The wives, they work in the Walmart stocking overnight. We went to Michigan, South Carolina. They're not making good money like here. So we came back here.
Very happy. Yeah. Everybody is very happy. Koshayans are very happy people.
Austin, Minnesota, 75 miles south of Savage, is home for about 40 Micronesians. And
spam, 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 spam.
The world's largest spam factory. Micronesians in Austin have similar backgrounds. They are mostly from Mokiel in Pohnpei. They came for work. And one way or another, they are involved with spam. Either here, where Hormel makes it, or preparing the meat at Quality Pork Processor, or getting it ready for the stores, including stores in Micronesia, at Austin Packaging. Life in Austin is simple, and the jobs pay well. Altoona, Iowa is a few hours' drive south of Savage. The town of 13,000 is home to about 25 Micronesians, mostly Pohnpeians. Rudy Ezekias is currently an auto technician with Jiffy Lube, a national oil change franchise. He came to the U.S. as a certified nursing assistant, or CNA, as did most of the other Micronesians in Altoona.
Some of my cousins was here. They worked the same program I was working, CNA.
I work at Altoona Healthcare Center. We take care of residents. We bathe them, we get them ready for meals, we feed them.
The pace of small town life seems to agree with Micronesians.
That's what we do here. We just go work, come back, play volleyball, baseball, basketball.
Allowing Micronesians time to reflect on life itself.
I learned how to control myself, patience, attitude, and all the good things people need in life. So far there is no regret for it, but I would say I gained a lot of benefit from it.
Junction City, a couple hours drive from Kansas City, is the off-base home to several Micronesians in the U.S. military.
I'm here for the Army. This is my duty station right now.
My job is 15 Romeo. I'm an Apache crew chief.
I'm a 19 kilo tanker.
I'm an infantry.
The military offers a promise of a solid career.
I'm a sergeant right now. I'm at it in 3 years.
If he remains in the military, Cyril can obtain his license as an aircraft mechanic.
As soon as I get the license, I'll be able to work on any aircraft anywhere in the world. All the Micronesians get together and have fun, because we're all in the military, we're in the States, and we're away from home, so we try to get together and get the island style going on.
Kasi lilyaman ko.
Micronesian immigrants today can be found in almost any part of the U.S., doing almost any type of work.
I work at Foot Locker Distribution Center. We receive the shoes and apparel from the vendors like Nike, Adidas, and then we send it out to the mall.
I work at this meat plant. They make sausages.
I do two part times and I go to school full time.
Cell phone accounts, all inquiries, account inquiries, setting up accounts, everything, any problems you have with your account, you call me, I take care of it.
We make plastic parts, like cell phone covers, building paper patios, retaining wall, even plant trees and, small plants, stuff like that.
Lumber buller and forklift driver.
And then they bring them into the sawmill where they get cut into boards, 6x6s, 4x6s.
4x4.
4x4s.
4x6, 6x6.
And 2x6 down to 2x4.
1x4, 1x6, 2x4, 2x6, 2x8, 2x10.
Many of the Micronesians in the U.S. work in nursing homes. Most of these were recruited and trained back in Micronesia.
I work at Pleasant Valley Nursing Home.
Altoona Healthcare.
I help the elderly.
I normally work as a certified nursing assistant. We do all the things that the parents do for kids. We put them to bed, we get them up ready for breakfast, supper. It's a very important field to work in.
This is our lower bay. I'm the lower bay tech. And this is pretty much where I work.
Micronesians are increasingly being recognized for their contributions in the workplace.
Rudy, he's a hell of a worker. He's probably the best lower bay tech that Jimmy Lube had.
There's the oil filter.
Rudy's oil change team is ranked in the top 10 nationwide. Advancing to the final round of a national tournament.
The
it's a 5-crew team, and first place you get like 10,000, so we're gonna split that 2,000 per person. So hey, I'll take that.
Park University has a long history having students here from Micronesia. Gentle is one of our best employees, and well, he is the best employee because he won Student Employee of the Year for all of Park University for 2008-2009 academic year.
Not surprisingly, Micronesians are moving up the ladder.
One of us Micronesians is supervising right now. He started work there like a couple of days after me, and right now he's my supervisor.
I'm a CNA, getting up to be a nurse or LPN or RN.
I've been working for Chicoloo for a while, and I'm planning to move up to a manager position and then hopefully someday own my own store.
Although these Micronesians have prospered in the U.S., they have not severed ties with their friends and family back in the islands.
There's no place like home.
I miss home.
I miss my family.
Back home in Bombay, I like fishing. That's what I do most of my time back home. And I miss the food. Yeah, the local food. The way we cook our food. I cannot do it here. We're gonna make the home right here. We're gonna get a ticket or something. But back home, oh no.
The limes, especially the limes. Yeah. And because over here, yeah, they have some kind of limes, but it's not the same as the limes that we have. And the bananas, yeah. The ripe bananas, yeah.
Oh, families. And the weather.
I miss the good fish, the local foods, and all the friends I have, and the family members that always support me while I was in school.
I missed Micronesia. I missed it very much.
The few family, friends, things you do.
From the South Pacific, and I am proud of my brownies to read. We can be found in the middle of the sea. Blue skies so bright, it's the only thing you see. And that's the only place I really wanna be. I can still survive from the boundary of the sea. If you see me walking on the beach, tropical breeze is the only wind you feel. Laid back, let's swing under the coconut tree with me.
Micronesians with experience in the U.S. often help new arrivals to get accustomed to a new way of life.
We're all family. We take them if they don't have paperwork like SS card and state IDs.
Stuff that you need for, you know, so you can get a job.
look for an apartment too. We can, you know, stop by and say how they doing, are everything all right.
You can send your kid from here to there to another relative. And then from there, that relative can, you know, basically show the way.
Jerry manages the Altoona Terrace Apartments.
I help him get started, get established in the community, and work with them. And they help me with odd jobs. I mean, some of the trimming and the mowing and the landscaping. Spread the love, Pacific wide, never judge a book by the cover, look deep inside. If time moves so fast, will the old tradition last? Come together, do it now, not a blast from...
But naturally, their hearts remain open to those they have left behind in the islands.
Last Christmas Eve, I ain't got no friends, ain't got nobody. I just stay in my room, using the phone, calling my fans back home.
We call them, they call us. You know, we feel that we're close together because of this conversation we always have over the telephone. Very good.
Oh, kasilelio. Yairan sheri kan. Yang airan maung rail.
I see a lot of them on MySpace, and that's pretty much the only place I've seen them. They like send comments back and forth, greetings, and telling each other how they miss each other.
Overwhelmingly, Micronesians share their good fortune with their families back home.
When we call them, you know, they ask, you know, my wife, they what they need, and you know, we try our best what we can do.
In times of need, they support, send money.
I know everybody here, they do send money back home to help the family.
Most Micronesians send money back home every month.
Well, I normally send like $300 a month.
I send about $200 to my dad and I send $150 to my sister.
In every month, I send like $300, $400 to my wife and my kids. If I don't send money, I'll buy some clothes.
We send clothes, candies for the kids, toys sometimes.
One time I sent a TV for my cousin.
A lot of the necessities that are not available here, that's just very cheap and available outside.
Besides regular remittances, gifts are commonly sent for special occasions.
From time to time, they send like our anniversary and our birthday and Christmas. They send not big money, but a small amount.
That's when I mostly send more money, is Christmas, Easter, of course, birthday.
Especially when there's funeral, we always send money back home to help the family buy bags and buy fish and whatever is needed for the occasion.
Surprisingly, holidays are not the most popular time to send money.
Our busiest month was during the U.S. tax refund time. That was set records. It was the month of February when most of the mainland Micronesians got their tax refunds, and that was off the charts.
During tax refund, they can receive $2,000 for each individual, sometimes $3,000, $4,000.
Historically, Micronesians have sent money from abroad by Western Union. But new money transfer methods are being used, including MoneyGram in Kosrae, as well as ATM and credit cards. Remittances can be surprisingly large, especially for Micronesians with entry-level positions struggling to make ends meet.
After I pay my rent, bills, kids' needs, my needs, and leftovers like $400, $500, I send it to my parents every 2 weeks.
One time, one of them sent me $1,000.
We're talking about between $4,000 to $5,000.
We've had a few transactions that have been over $10,000.
They send in more than $15,000 a year.
Despite the distance, Micronesians abroad fulfill their traditional obligations to their families in the islands.
I just want to do something for my mother.
I'd say my main reason here is working and sending money back home.
That's why we're here, you know?
That's my goal when I left my parents, to help back out my parents.
But just how to fulfill those obligations is not always clear.
Okay, so they're saying that they want them there. But maybe their kids are thinking they need to take care of them. But the only way they can take care of them is to come and work and send them that money. So which do we pick, really?
How are the people back home getting along? But she's cold inside. She wants to be like the water. Blood ties and community bonds remain strong, even with those who have moved great distances from Micronesia.
There's nowhere else like home.
Yes, I miss home so much.
I kind of feel bad. I'm not there to help my family.
So in a way, it's good and it's bad. I guess it depends how you see it.
The families of these immigrants might be sad to see them leave, but they clearly benefit from their remittances.
He sends us goods. He sends things for the kids. Whenever he calls, we tell him what we need and he sends it. Whenever he finds a job, he sends us money.
But this money from relatives abroad is sometimes used for more substantial items.
Some parents are receiving huge amount of money from their kids out there. They're saving up on a car or building a new house or just renovating their house.
He asked me to visit, but I don't want to go yet. I'd rather spend the money on a new refrigerator or go to the dentist. And I want to build a cookhouse over there. I'd rather use the money for things that are more important.
For some time, the mother and I have been planning on repairing the roof of our house.
with the additional cash infusion, we've got ahead.
This belongs to our uncle and aunt. It was built with money sent from Guam and America. They sent the money and we bought the supplies on Wena to build it.
Remittance money has made a difference for families in the islands.
Last week, there was an emergency at the hospital, and this man came in to get his money. He said that money was for, he's leaving the next day.
I had been sending money for like a year or 2 years, and it wasn't until I actually went back to Yap to see, my family, that I really hit home, That thing I picked up at Walmart that I thought was like a clever idea was actually being used for 6 different things in the house.
It has been a blessing for whole communities as well.
When there is a Kamete Pong goes up, we donate monies and they send him an envelope.
If we were to ask for something, we would ask for tools and equipment to fix and clean up the road.
They send money directly to the church where they are building the new churches.
Yet, money isn't everything. For those who send, as well as those who receive these remittances, the abandoned houses in many villages are a silent witness to the loss of their former occupants.
If you go down and you see my village, maybe 50% is Hawaii, 50% is there. Most of them, they move out, and their houses is being abandoned.
They left their place, their houses. When they coming back to their troop, their houses already damaged. They cannot stay inside there. Then they just go and stay with their relatives.
Now it's not move the whole family, move the whole village.
Yeah.
This is the main road in Fongan. It has been damaged by the water. Cars cannot drive on it anymore like they used to. There are not enough people here anymore to work on it because most of them have moved away.
Public elementary schools are no longer bursting at the seams with students. After all, the population has remained stable for the last 15 years now. In fact, some village schools have been closed. As those in pursuit of jobs have moved on to the U.S., they have left behind their family and friends. The money they send back is appreciated, but it cannot quiet the sense of loss that many of the older people feel.
I want him to come back now that I am getting old and weak. It's difficult for me to talk about him because every time I do, I cry. I love him and miss him so much.
When I get old, I like to be with my children and my grandchildren together with them.
Well, it is time for you to leave again. You know it hurts me every time.
40,000 Micronesians, who might have remained in their islands, are now living abroad. This immigration has altered the face of the nation. It has changed the lives of those who have left and those who stayed at home.
It's not like back home. You can live without even working for a year or, you know, as long as you want and still live. But over here, if you don't work, if you don't have money, I don't know where you're gonna end up.
I don't want them to, especially the children, to forget their own language.
When they come back, they tend to, when they speak, they're mixing up the words, or they talk like people that don't really know the language. So we call those people Peace Corps when they do that.
The eldest, the daughter, she's able to speak over the telephone. And she can speak Panapean. Yes, that's right. I'm very happy about it.
I learned quite a bit being outside of Micronesia. It expanded my thinking.
I feel like grow up by myself, trying to do everything for myself.
I walk around, I don't see my friends anymore. I want to see them.
Immigration has also affected the aspirations of young islanders today.
My plan is to attend COM Palliker Point B National Campus, and if I luckily get my AS degree there, then I'll try to further on my education to Hawaii or in the States where I can get a bachelor's degree.
Some say that emigration might have acted as a negative force on economic and social developments in the islands. After all, there are very likely future doctors and nurses and other professionals among those thousands who have left the islands for a bright future somewhere else.
And I feel very sad because we already have brain drain in the nation, and now we are trying to prepare young people to go there.
I plan to move to Hawaii to continue in accounting. If they have the program here, I'll stay here and take all the classes because it's more closer to my family.
I want to go to attend school in America, to study to become a doctor.
These immigrants do indeed help their country in other ways. The remittances they send back home have become an important factor in the growth of the nation.
So what you're sending to Gosai, you may think it's small in size, but together when we look at the numbers, it's about 10% or over 10% of the state GDP or state economy. That's over $1.5 million. It increases the income for the households, and the households will have more money to spend buying services and products. So when they do that, the government will benefit because it will pay the taxes.
An estimated $30 million a year comes to FSM through remittances. This is the largest source of funds outside the annual compact payments from the U.S.
This is a big, very huge amount. You combine tourism, agriculture, and fisheries, remittance is bigger than all three.
Sometimes 40 customers in one day, sometimes 60 to 70 customers one day.
I would say on a good Saturday, I can get 100 people.
I would say 20 to 50 people per day receive money transfer services from MoneyGram. Lately, it's been over $150,000 a month for the past 4 or 5 months.
These missing Micronesians, the thousands of immigrants who have left their country to live and work abroad, represent a valuable resource for FSM.
It's something that should not be discouraged. It's something that should be encouraged for all of us, including those living abroad.
As they are settling into their new homes and jobs in Neosho, Eau Claire, Pasadena, and 100 other places in the U.S., they are providing a source of financial assistance that is growing each year. Not only are they finding the job opportunities and schools and healthcare they need to provide for their own families, but they have become a rich source of support for those they have left.
Before he left, he helped our family in many ways. Now he sends us money from the States.
If the islands of FSM have few resources or products to export, they can at least do what many other Pacific nations have done successfully for years. They can export their labor. And they can use the proceeds of that labor to develop their own struggling economy. Those missing Micronesians may be absent from their island homes, but they continue to make a significant contribution to their family and friends and country.
You get to fish here?
In a pond, catching catfish, and it's different.
How's that?
Back there, you never catch a fish and unhook it and throw it back in the water.
I got a spare bag of rice there.
Yeah, we go to Eau Claire, Wasa to get rice. Mm-hmm. We cannot eat the rice from the stores
Why?
Here.
Tastes like crackle.
But Rudy is famous for keeping ramen noodles downstairs. He's constantly making noodles down there.
You say, I love Minnesota.
I love Minnesota.
Do we have snow?
No, we don't.
Here, we have snow. We have circus. We got soup.
We don't have a soup at home.
No, we don't.
We have a stew here.
Elevators, escalators, and drive-thrus.
I want to go back, but I can't leave my job because they won't let me for that long.